welcome to another episode of Business with Passion. Each show features guests who have transformed their long-term passion into a successful business. I'm your host, Jay Hamilton Roth. My marketing strategy business grew from my love of talking with passionate business owners. In this series, I share their passion with you. So if you're looking for inspiration to enhance your business passion, keep watching.
My name's Noah Miller.
My name's Logan Miller.
And we're the authors of Either You're In or You're In the Way, and the writer, directors, producers, and actors in Touching Home.
Starring Ed Harris. I played at Texas Tech for a year.
And I played at Southern Arkansas University, and things didn't really work out. Flunked out.
And then we went. I was playing with the Blue Jays at the time. Noah came and picked me up in Florida. I had just had surgery. They released me. Noah came and picked me up in Florida, and we drove back home and worked with our dad, saved our money to go back down to Arizona for tryouts and try and get back into baseball.
Well, the passion for writing, I just think it was something that we grew into, really. Once baseball didn't work out, we had nothing to fall back on. We didn't want to go back home and be roofers. And we always loved telling stories orally, not writing them down. And ran into this, first we wanted to tell a story about us and our father, and then we ran into this guy who steered us towards Lou Hunter's 434, which is a screenwriting handbook, and it made sense, and so we started writing.
On January 5th, 2006, our father died on the cement floor of a jail cell. He'd been in and out of jail over the past several years due to alcohol-related offenses, locked up this time since mid-December. He said nobody really messed with him in there because he was one of the oldest inmates, and the guy sort of respected him for that. He was also the resident artist. Our father spent his last Christmas and New Year's behind bars. His name was Daniel Arthur Miller. He was 59. Our dad had been homeless for the last 15 years, mostly living in his truck, until it was confiscated by the courts 10 months earlier. He'd been battling alcoholism his entire adult life and was now sleeping in a thicket of Scotch broom, his hideout, on a wooded hillside in Fairfax, a small town 20 miles north of San Francisco. We had given him a pager for Christmas years earlier so we could stay in touch. If we paid him and he didn't call back within a couple hours, he was either on a drinking binge or in jail. Otherwise, he was more reliable than Swiss time. He knew every payphone in the area. It was cold that week in November, the temperature dipping into the 20s. Early Monday morning, we found our dad walking down the road, hands in his pockets, hunched over, brutal after night in the woods. He was wearing a thick down jacket and a backpack, incoherent, muttering to himself. We were supposed to meet him in town at 11 a.m. It was now 7 a.m. and we were happy to see him early, make a longer day out of it. "Hey, Dado," Logan yelled out the window as we pulled alongside him and stopped. "How you doing?" He was shivering. It took him a moment to recognize us. "Get in," Logan said. "We're going to have a great day." He got in our car. The skin under his eyes was swollen from the cold, leaves in his hair. There was no energy to him, no happiness, no warmth of life. He usually lit up when he saw us, but there was no light today. Tomorrow, he was going to start serving a 30-day sentence at the Sonoma County Jail. He'd never been in the Sonoma County Jail before and didn't know how he'd be treated. Didn't know if some young punk would mess with him or any of the other that can hit you in jail. He didn't know anybody in Sonoma County, and he was uneasy about it. "No worries, Dada," we told him. Today was his day. We were going to spend some money on him, treat him to all the good stuff, whatever he wanted. But he said he couldn't spend the day with us, wasn't in the right state of mind to be around people, couldn't sit inside a dark movie theater. He was in a bad way, the worst we'd ever seen him, like an abandoned dog on a lonely street. We just wanted to hug him and tell him everything was going to be all right. He'd been a roofer for 35 years, but no one would hire him anymore. He said he's practically begging for a job. Doesn't feel good, you know. He'd lost his pride, and that was most painful to see. "We're going to start making movies, Dad. You just got to hang on for a few more years, and then we'll take care of you."
"I can't keep starting over." "Don't worry," we told him. "We'll get through this."
Thought about the last time we saw him on that cold day in November and what he told us in the car just before we dropped him off. "I wish I could have been better boys to you growing up. I wish I could have been better to you boys growing up. Sorry that I wasn't. I had never been able to be there for you 100%, and I know I never will be. Thanks for never giving up on me."
We tried to cheer him up. "We're going to start making movies, Dad. We're really close. We're going to do some great things together. Fishing in Alaska, camping in Montana, sailing the oceans like we've always dreamed. You just got to take better care of yourself."
I know. Then we remembered a few months before that, the last time we visited him in jail. He lifted up his orange shirt, revealing his lean stomach, and hit his abs with his fist. "This is where you come to get fit. When are you going to make our movie?" "Soon, Dad, soon. Who's going to play me? He's got to be good looking." Ed Harris. He always reminded us of our dad. "Yeah, he's good. I'll give him permission to be me. The sheriff will negotiate on my behalf." We all laughed. It was a jailhouse dream, an impossible dream, something to be accomplished in another lifetime when you could start over and make all the right decisions. Ed Harris was light years from our moment.
Well, everyone told us we were nuts and insane, you know, I think at first. You know,
we had a ton of help from people, you know, coming on board from Gordon Radley's been, he's a former president of Lucasfilm. He's sort of been our mentor over the last 5 years.
And really helped us out.
Yeah, he really helped us, you know, kind of, the way he sort of instructs you is he points you in the right direction and kicks you in the ass. And then of course all of our friends, our family, and then Jeremy Zajon, our producing partner, Jason Holthy is a very good friend of ours. He's sort of kind of the brain.
We have a tremendous team.
You know, making movies is team art. You can't do it without a team. So we've made that sort of parallel between sports and filmmaking kind of early on, where we said, okay, you know, this is team art. What do we need to do? We need to assemble the best team possible.
How significant was Ed Harris coming on board and actually getting the movie made? And I mean, it was sort of the linchpin. I mean, without him, it's, you know, so you can always say, well, if this hadn't happened, then that wouldn't happen. But yeah, without him coming on board, it would have been, I don't know. It might not happen. It most certainly wouldn't happen. And so, yeah, for him to, and he was taking a huge risk too. All we had shot was this little 2-minute trailer, and we'd financed that on 17 credit cards, and in a way, we thought that our pops was upstairs, you know, working some magic or something, but if Ed hadn't come on board, I mean, I don't know, but it was absolutely crucial. And a little anecdote, it's in the book, so I'm not going to give all of it. But Ed, after we talked to him in San Francisco, he took the script home, he read it, he said, I like it, let's get together, talk about when you guys are going to do this movie. And initially he couldn't find time to do it, and that's all in the book, so I'll skip that. But then finally when Ed was able to do it, he came up and we drove out to the locations, and he said, you guys know where we can grab a good burger? And we said, yeah, this place, M&G's in Fairfax. We used to go there with our dad. And about halfway into our burgers, Ed said, you know, I know what you guys are up against. You guys got, you know, a ton of pressure. You're under a ton of pressure. And he said, look, I just want you to know that I'm here to help you realize your dream.
And once he said that, I was like,
yeah. We couldn't have made the movie without the support of you know, people from Fairfax West. It would have never been made. We simply could have.
A lot of sneaking around at night in the dark. True. That's true. You used to be able to get credit cards up until about a year and a half ago. We had a whole bunch of them. Oh, we still have a whole bunch of them. Actually, our credit's great because we went into huge debt and then paid them off. If we sell enough books, you'll see it in the theater, guaranteed. So it's going to, you know, it's sooner or later to happen. We just don't know
if we'll still be alive.
Yeah.
And the thing that really inspired me about this book is its inspirational quality. It is, besides just being fun, it's also very, very moving about when you have an idea or a vision or something that you really want to accomplish, what it takes and how, even when things don't work, how you can tweak that idea and just continue to develop some other idea that most people would say that's impossible. You know, that's impossible. How could you make a movie? You don't know how to make a movie. You don't have money to make the movie. You know, how could you even go after your baseball dream? And they just continually went after their dreams. And that's the thing about reading the book that is so incredible for me. Just that push and that rousing kind of sensibility that, given how difficult life has been for them at times, very difficult, how they just decided this was something that we wanted to do. We want to make this movie. We want to honor our father. We want to learn these things. We want to read a lot more. We want to, you know, get into film. We want to make a screenplay. And one thing after another, they just put their minds to it and went crazy and got going on this idea. And, oh, my God, here we are today.
We had no intention of ever writing a book, okay? Oh, sorry. Not a book on this book. This one. Other books, yes. Not this one. But so what happened is, once we were done shooting the movie and we got in the editing room, we started our schedule changed a little bit to where we could go down and have a cup of coffee in Fairfax, or see some, you know, maybe have a going to San Francisco or whatnot, and people would, you know, they'd be like, God, you know, I haven't seen you guys in, you know, a year. You know, your father passed away. I'm sorry to hear that. But you made a movie with Ed Harris. What is going on? So we would tell people the story of how we made our movie, and to the person, they'd be like, you guys got to do something. That's your next movie. And we're like, well, we're just trying to finish our movie. Thanks for the idea. And then they'd be like, well, write a book or something. And we're like, oh, okay, sure, yeah. You know, we're not busy. But so we kept hearing it. And then so.
And then this guy, he loves to overcommit us.
Yeah.
He started just saying, look, we got to write this book. We got to write this book. If we, our editor would show up at around 10:30, 11 and stay till 10:30, 11 at night. And Noah kept saying, look, if we write from 5:30 in the morning until Robert Dalbert, our editor, shows up, he said, look, we'll have a first draft in a few months, and we'll be glad that we did it. It's all fresh right now.
It's fresh, and it's all because as you'll see as what we learned. Well, I don't even know if we learned it, but what we did is to get every person on board. You retell the story where you started up to where they fit in, and so the book. By the end of it, we would pitch someone, and it would take an hour, right? Because you're talking about everything you'll hear in the book, and so the book was in our head, and so we puked it out. Like, we don't even remember. No, I'm serious. I don't even remember writing the first draft. Don't even remember it.
Because it was crazy. Because we really weren't sleeping much. We weren't sleeping much at all. At all.
I remember writing it, but I don't remember writing any specific. Unlike the screenplays that we've written, I can tell you days where we came up with the dialogue, where we were at, and this and that. But with this, we just threw it out. You know, maybe that's why it's got the real short sentences with no vocabulary whatsoever. You know what I mean? I don't know.
But yeah, so a lot of coffee too.
Yeah.
How did we come up with the title of the book? And that was, we just started telling ourselves, either you're in or you're in the way. And that was just, and it was tongue in cheek. I mean, we never told anybody, look,
you're in the way.
Yeah.
Do you want to be in or do you want to be in the way? Because it'll crack your skull. No,
it was just something we started telling ourselves to kind of maintain our conviction, because throughout the entire process,
as you'll read in here, you know, people were telling us we can't do it,
and we had never like each stage, we had no experience for what we were going into unless we had read something about it or spoke to somebody in the business, and so there was so much self doubt and so much anxiety, and every day we battled. Like, what are we doing? We can't do this. This is ridiculous. Like,
everyone's, you know, right. We aren't saying.
Yeah, and so that was just something that we kept saying. We'd be like, we'd be driving in the car, and we'd be like, either you're in or you're in the way. Yeah. And sometimes I'd be like, Noah, you're in the way.
Yeah,
you know?
We just say it, just especially after the bad meetings, and then we'd start laughing about it. You kind of go, at least you try to, and then, you know, you just say to yourself and start laughing.
It's a benefit that we have each other because. As far as relationships are concerned, we're always looking out for each other, and you always, you know, try to be very considerate and patient with each other. So patience is probably the most difficult, but you try to be thoughtful and aware of what he's, you know, what's going on with him, and we try and do that with our friends as well.
Two guys who love each other. It's been said we have an unusual relationship. Bro is me, and I am bro. We're identical twins. We share everything. It's been like that since the womb. Before that, it was an egg, and before that, it's hard to say. We have one cell phone, one computer, and one car between us. Not saying there would be a bad thing to have two of each, but right now, money is tight. So for now, we share, and are blessed to have someone to share with.
We've always been best friends and have always helped each other, except when we tried to resolve our conflicts by punching one another. We stopped doing that once we started breaking noses and knocking out permanent teeth. It got expensive. So now our arguments never escalate beyond intellectual frustration, if we may boldly say so.
Each of us would rather the other guy succeed. If there's only one trophy, we want the other to have it. If there's only one princess, then bro can have her. We cook for each other and serve more food to the other guy.
Thought experiment. Let's just say that we, the bros, had only 51% of a brain apiece. Unfortunate, yes, but paralyzing, no. Because if we work together, we have 102%, which is 2% more than any human on the planet. Beat Einstein if you were still around.
People often ask us, do you really share everything? Yeah, just about. Then they'll usually say something stupid like, even underwear? Chuckle, chuckle. Yes, even underwear, smart. But it's not like one of us wears a pair on Monday and then flips it to the other guy on Tuesday. We wash them first. Then we flip them. Then the most common question, so what's it like being twins? And we usually reply with, what's it like being you? It's our reality. It's what we know. What do you know? Tough question, isn't it? It's rather broad. Hopefully, by the end of this adventure, you'll have a better understanding of what it is, and perhaps so shall we. Bro is me, and I am bro.
You know, writing is our passion. Writing and directing, but both screenwriting and book writing. We love nothing more than getting up in the morning, brewing a cup of coffee, and, you know, jumping behind the keys. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, it's definitely our passion. And then we love, you know, directing. This is our first movie that we directed, and we really love working with actors, setting up shots, just the entire process of filmmaking. It was exhilarating. It was the best time we've ever had.
Our goal right now is to get this book on the bestseller list, and we have no idea how you do that, other than sell a lot of books. Yeah. So we'll do our best to sell as many books, to get the movie theatrically distributed. And we have 11 other screenplays that we've written, so we'd like to make one of them next. Yeah. So, how we're gonna do that? It's just the same way we started this, and it's kind of when we get up each morning, we kind of try and figure out how we're gonna do whatever we're gonna do. Yeah. We make a plan. The plan never seems to work.
Yeah, you'll find out on the book because we're gonna do this.
The plan never works.
Tenacity. You got to be tough. You know. You gotta just persevere and just keep going. Just keep going and going and going.
Yeah, just keep going. You know, and you'll figure it out along the way. I think too, a lot of times people, they don't embark on, you know, some sort of project or you know, any sort of undertaking because they feel they're not prepared enough, you know, to begin. But the thing is that you learn as you move along. You know, you're never gonna be prepared enough. You know, that's just something that you know, you can always talk yourself out of reasons, you know, for not doing something because you're not prepared enough. So you know, you're never going to be. You just got to go after it and learn along the way and adapt and improvise. You know, the movie and the book tanked, then we'd
keep doing what we've been doing.
Yeah, start setting up the next movie, write the next book. There's nothing we'd rather do than write and make movies. You know, if we could go back to baseball, we wouldn't.
Yeah.
You know, I think we're much better people as a result of baseball not working out, and much more rounded and have far more interests now.
The Giants invited us to show the movie on the Jumbotron, and then we got the book deal shortly after that, and so we just got to thinking, okay, well, why don't we have the book?
You know, some sort of book launch at the park, and then I think Jer coined the name Bookstock.
The cure for the recession depression is Bookstock. Now, Cheryl mentioned it earlier, but that's the event we're going to be throwing at AT&T Park, June 6th. And so anyone who, you know, has been hurt by, you know, the recession, who is just not feeling so good about their life, who enjoys breakfast, water, has kids, drives a car, rides a bike. This is going to be a great event, and we would love for you all to come.
Where's it going to be?
Oh, did I say?
No.
AT&T Ballpark, home of the
And all you have to do to get in is buy a book. One book admits two people.
So if you've already bought the book, you're in.
Yeah. You don't even need to bring it. You can just bring the receipt. And there's going to be
kids 12 and under.
Yeah, sorry, kids 12 and under are free. And so basically, if you're a little league coach, you could buy one book and bring 20 kids if you want.
Or if you teach fourth grade, fifth grade, fourth. Well, when I was in third, I was 12. But most of y'all.
Sorry, we're gonna have live music, live art, beer and wine garden. Then we're gonna watch the movie on the big screen at 8:30.
By either you're in or you're in the way at Book Passage. Get a free ticket to Bookstock, music, art, books. The largest single title book party in the world ever. Meet Ed Harris and the Miller Brothers. Get your book signed and see their movie, Touching Home.
All you had to do was let me win. Why didn't you just let me win? You didn't have to. That's stupid.
You did win.
The book is, you know, it's a gonzo journey about two guys going after a dream with no experience. It'll make you laugh and it'll make you cry. Touches on a lot of emotions, and
the book is ultimately, it's an inspirational story about a promise that we made to our father, and then you know, following our dreams, you know.
So, all the more reason to come out to Bookstock at AT&T Park, June 6th.
I just say go after your dream and don't let anybody tell you can't do it. You know, I mean that's the only advice we have, is really just to even when you believe in where you're going. And you don't need to believe, like, moment by moment. There's going to be all this self-doubt and insecurity that sets in, that's going to plague you along the way. But it's as long as you don't let it prevent you from moving forward.
Thanks for watching this episode of Business with Passion. If you'd like more information about Noah and Logan Miller, other shows, or perhaps to be a guest on a future show, go online to tv.manygoodideas.com.